And welcome to the PWA March Connection. My name is Milena Padula and I am the PWA Social Director. We are here to know something more about the W20 roadmap for women empowerment. Before we start, I would like to ask our president, Gerli Saura, to give her welcome remarks. Please, Gerli.
Thank you, Milena. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, PWA members, friends, honored guests, Inclusione Donna Associations, presidents and ambassadors. Welcome to PWA. My name is Gerli Saura, president of PWA, Professional Women's Association of Rome, an association that promotes gender equality, empowerment and leadership of women in the world of work. Together with the board of directors comprised 12 women of diverse backgrounds and cultures, since 1992, PWA has been operating in Rome as a nonprofit association. It has always been promoting the importance of the role of women in society, rewarding both diversity and sustainability, and believes that now more than ever, the social cultural restart of our economy depends on the strengthening of women in the world of work. The promotion of gender equality of women empowerment is central to the United Nations and the G20, and it is a key concept in the agenda of Italy's G20 presidency. It entails a series of policies and complementary measures to promote empowerment, as well as women's and girls' leadership in the economic and social spheres. The W20 this year has in fact passed the decision to present a roadmap on female empowerment under the Italian presidency. It will be fundamentally focused on some measures and monitorable key strategic points. So we gather tonight to understand and ask ourselves if we want to be part of these strategic solutions. And tonight, join me personally, to deep dive and understand what is our opportunity and our role to the W20 roadmap to women's empowerment. What a great honor to host our panelists, Honorable Linda Laura Sabadini, Chair of W20, Elvira Marasco, Head of W20, Martina Rogato, Sherpa W20, and Monica Carco, our own PWA member of management team of W20, and an international civil servant for 30 years. We call on individuals, organizations, and nations to support the W20 team by making their work efficient to further progress women's empowerment across the three cross-cutting sections under the G20 agenda. I know that success will be when the inclusion of women comes into reality in all policies and prosperity when it is integrated into the production of well-being of our society. With that combined forces, technology and globalizations, there's no better time to transform our current way of life into one with more economic gender inclusivity. Welcome to PWA.
Thank you very much, Gerli. And as Gerli was saying, PWA believes that women are, have a unique opportunity to lead a long overdue transformation. The pandemic requires an acceleration of strategies for achieving gender equality in all areas. And I would like now to speak about a project that in December 2020, PWA presented. In fact, PWA took part together with other associations in a meeting with the W20 engagement group to present its project on policies to support maternity with the creation of more nurseries to support women that struggle in their career because of the lack of services dedicated to children. Our proposal is divided into three main points: integration of public services for children, especially for children aged 0-3, encouragement of shared childcare services for companies, with particular attention to the reality of small and medium enterprises, and review of the school calendar with particular attention to the summer closing period in order to facilitate families with children. We are pleased to notice that the recovery fund includes measures to increase the number of nurseries, just as stated in the PWA proposal. Let me now introduce Monica Carco. For over 30 years, Monica has worked as an international civil servant for UN agencies. Since 2020, Monica is part of the W20 management team. And last but not least, she's also a PWA member. Monica, could you tell us why a woman with your international experience has decided to join W20 and PWA in the same year?
Dear Milena, many thanks for giving me the floor. Dear Gerli, thank you for this invitation. I'm really pleased to be with you today, and I think this topic is very close to our heart, all of us. Yes, I am part of the PWA. I'm a new associate, let's say, and I'm also part of the management team of Women 20, which is the engagement group of the G20 Italy 2021. So I am in this very special position to talk about the reasons why I've joined PWA, but at the same time, why I joined Women 20. I've been thinking about it, and I will share with you some of my thoughts. First of all, the common element of this decision is my commitment to gender equality. I don't know if you have read, but I'm reading the book of Isabel Allende, the last one, which came out, The Soul of a Woman. And she says in her biography, it's actually a biography, she says that she was a feminist since the time of her kindergarten. And so she tells a story when she was a child, and the mother was abandoned by the husband, and she became very soon aware of the inequalities and discrimination within the family, but also in the society. It made me think that I think most of us have become sooner or later aware of the discrimination and the inequalities within the family, but also outside. And I think each one of us has fight against patriarchy in our own ways, with our own pace, and different level of engagement. Also different in our time of our life. There are moments where fighting is a close, it's a need and it's a must. And there are times when we lay back a bit. I consider myself a feminist, and I became very much aware of the culture bias around me. And I started fighting as a feminist during university time to defend the abortion law. You might remember in Italy, there was a movement against the law, which was already approved. And that was the time where I experienced working with other women and fighting for the same goals. And then I joined the United Nations, and it has not been easy, because despite of course, compiling to the SDGs and the Millennium Development Goals and the objectives of the United Nations agenda, I think we women have to fight all the time for our rights. So at some point, I decided to develop programs for technical assistance in developing countries, concentrating my efforts to support women entrepreneurship development. As a matter of fact, I worked for UNIDO most of my career, and UNIDO works for industrial development, so economic development. And this has been the time where I decided to really formulate programs which were focusing on women as beneficiary of the technical assistance. And to do that, I developed an holistic model which would work at macro, meso, micro level. based on the assumption that there are multiple factors that prevents women to access the services required to start or expand a business. And I think most of the audience is actually made by professional women, so they know what it means, a red tape. And they know what it means to find your own ways in an ecosystem that does not facilitate women in starting up a business. So by looking at developing countries and looking at similarities of problematics encountered by women in developed and developing countries, I've been designing programs which were aiming at removing the barriers, financial, training, coaching, networking, policies, always trying to establish a circle of communication between beneficiary of the project, so women entrepreneurs, and the policy level, which is government, that have to implement the right policies to support women. The network, the link between the macro and micro level have been for me, and it is in the society, the women business associations. So I worked with many women business associations in developing countries, but also in Europe. And that has been a way to multiply the impact of the activities developed by the project. So when I had the last important activities that I carried out at UNIDO last year in July 2020 was the organization of a conference for women's economic empowerment. And that's where, that has been the time when I really got in touch with PWA, and I developed with them their participation. They've been extremely active, very professional. It's an association that has immediately caught the sense and the advantage of being part of the conference. They are very active on bilateral side in networking with other women business associations. And I was extremely impressed by the professionality and the international esprit of the people who worked for PWA. So when I decided to move to Rome on early retirement from United Nations, I joined PWA. And the reason, one of the major, the feeling gives me PWA is that it's an association that has a soul and has a direction. They care about individual women and their stories, but at the same time, they constantly strive for supporting women as professionals with training and meetings. I also met during the last years of my work with UNIDO, I also met AIDA and Elvira, who will talk after me. Elvira is part of AIDA, which is another women visit. I think it was established AIDA in the early 60s in Italy as a professional business association. And so we had a chat, we discussed, and she suggested to join the Women 20. And as much as I can, of course, I'm supporting the team with my focus on entrepreneurship and finance, which is one of the theme of Women 20. And I'm also supporting as much as I can with my knowledge, my network, and my belief. So to respond, Milena, to your question, it's really team game. We are here today to talk about Women 20, and there are themes and topics which are very important. I've seen some of the questions which have been raised already, looking at reasons why inequality still persists. And I think Women 20 is a multilateral dimension, political and multilateral dimension, very important to not only to promote change at government level, so to request governments to really focus on women's empowerment priorities, but also to promote the cultural change, which is required in our societies to fight against stereotypes, to fight against behavior and laws that hamper the promotion of women as individual, but as a professional women as well. So My core business is cooperation, alliance, working together, joint action. And I think if we want to win the battle, we must play the team game. So thank you, Milena, for giving me the opportunity to talk about my involvement with your with PWA, but also with Women 20. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Monica. I think we are very lucky to have you in PWA, and I'm sure you will be an inspiration for our members and a trade union between our association and the W20 management team to help us to promote gender policies. So now let's give the floor to Elvira Marasco. Elvira is a public relations expert and a journalist since 2018. Elvira is an Italian delegate of the engagement group W20. As a delegate, she attended the Buenos Aires and Tokyo summit, and Saudi Arabia as well, as I knew today. And she has been working with several associations like AIWA, Arab Italian Women Association, and AIDA, Association of Women Business Managers Company. Elvira is now the head of the Italian delegation of the W20. Please, Elvira, I give the floor to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all our friends. I want to say one thing. We are lucky to have Monica in our team because really it's a pleasure to work with her. Let's say that we are a very good team. I want to say to all the people this. We are a very good team and we spend a lot of time of our free time because we are not paid for this job. And it is a pleasure to spend time with people that really you appreciate it. This is the first things. So just I want to tell to you what is this Women 20 that till now not too many people they really focus it what really it is. It is, I think everybody knows that is an engagement group focused on gender equality. From 2015, under Turkish G20 presidency, the W20 is, they realized that women, they were not too much, let's say, taking I had a moment of confusion. I want to say that I'm not very happy to say that we start only in 2015 under the Turkish presidency because this engagement group was decided because first of all must be independent from governments. In its functioning, it mirrors the G20 process. Its primary objective is to ensure that the gender consideration are mainstreamed into G20 discussion, because this is the core of the W20, because we can talk with all these people, our friends, female association, but at the end of the day, who decide is the G20. That's why we have to be also to pay attention to this and to be sure that this consideration, our consideration, are mainstreamed into G20 discussion and into the G20 and into the leader declaration. This is the main thing. The policy success of the W20 over the years has been, I think, in large part, due to continuity and agility, the group, they have from the beginning, three legacy policy priorities, which are carried over expanded, developed under each presidencies. These are labor inclusion, labor, digital, and financial entrepreneurship. Based on years of research and analysis, because we are not talking about talks, we are talking about works, who is done with a knowledge partner at the level of OECD, of ILO, or UN agencies. And for with this company, the W20 has discerned that these priorities constitute the main tools that will pave the way for a gender equitable future. This is very, I mean, I'm very proud to say these words because it means that really we suddenly realize and we catch the attention of the male floor. For that purpose, the W20 develops an address to the G20 leaders, a communique, because we work all the year of the presidency to hold this communique, which contains a series of policy recommendations aimed to fostering gender equality and women's economic empowerment in order to boost gender inclusive economic growth for each and every country, because we're talking about 20 countries. The 2020 G20 Leaders Summit in Riyadh declared that coordinated global action, solidarity, and multilateral cooperation are more necessary today than ever to overcome the current challenges and realize opportunities for the 21st century for all by empowering people, safeguarding the planet, and shaping new frontiers. The 2021 G20 under the Italian presidency will take the lead, took the lead in ensuring the international response to the pandemic while building up resilience to future health-related shocks. It will be focused on three broad interconnected pillars of action, which are people, planet, and prosperity. In this frame, Women 20 has decided to focus its 2021 presidencies on five core themes. We usually, we have all the presidencies of Women 20, they have three core themes. And the current presidencies can add one or two themes. It's up to them. In Japan, it was governance. This time, we, as Italian presidencies, we decide to add two other themes. These other two themes are violence against women, which is a terrible theme, and environmental sustainability. While digital finance and labor are three historical, as I said before, W20 issue, that have been extensively analyzed over the past 5 years. Violence against women has been often mentioned in the previous communique and other W20 official documents. Greater measures in this field still need to be implemented. This is absolutely, it should be really one of on the most important things to do. Furthermore, environment sustainability is instead a new topic of discussion. The 2021 will also discuss two special cross topic focused on cultural change and equity in health. The 2021 proposed the framework takes into consideration the challenges that follow the COVID, the terrible pandemic, that W20 legacy and G20 goals are core topics for the upcoming year, of course. So I want to say also that we are a troika. We are part of a troika, which is the backbone of the W20. The troika is composed of the country currently hosting of the W20 forum. In this case, is Italy. The previous host, which is Saudi Arabia, and the upcoming host, which is Indonesia. Next year will be in Indonesia. As in the G20, the presidencies must work together with past and future presidencies. It's normally because you cannot start a presidency, okay, we do completely different. Doesn't work like this. Anyway, we have a lot of duties. We have to collect funds. So this is the worst things we have to do because it's very difficult. And we have also to do a big work in preparation of the communique, working with all our delegates, which are in the world almost 100. And they come from the civil society. They are from a university, from NGO, from association, all women that really, they work very hard on these topics. And they really, they can do the difference. It's a custom for the presidencies to set the year agenda and to take a lead role in moderating the development of this communique, which is the paper that we will give to our prime minister during our summit, which will be in Rome in presence. I want to be in a summit in presence on July 13, 14, 15, and we will present this paper with all our recommendation to our premier. So I'm late in the timing because I don't see, if I'm speaking too much, please stop me, because you know, I talk too much sometimes. Girlie, please stop me. Anyway, just I want to tell you another things about delegates, but because each W20 delegation is constituted by delegates chosen according with the G20 member process. They are, as I told you, from the university or GM, and we can also, as W20, invite experts, as well as friends of the presidencies for the duration of their mandate, but cannot appoint additional delegates in just because, it's a friend of mine, why come in the delegation? No, we select, but we want to have friends and we want to share our topics because it's very important that if we can really represent all the civil society. What I want to say, another things that we are lucky, but because we have a special person who works with us, which is Martina Rogato. Martina Rogato, she's the Sherpa, she's the spokesperson of the W20. She's very prepared and really she has the, she takes the let's say the, all the contents that we have to share with the other engagement group, because we have consolidating synergies with the other engagement group. They are 8. And because at the end of these presidencies, we have to create joint statement initiatives also to support this advocacy effort. Because yes, I think more we do things, more we attract their attention. We engage also with other, the G20 groups, relevant initiatives, focused always on women, empowerment. We coordinated also international organization and institution to consolidate these topics. And we have the great opportunity to work with great knowledge partner, like, as I told before, OECD. Anyway, I try to explain how Women 20 is going to act, but I think Martina, that I think she will talk about me after me, she can explain better about the topics and the items that really we are working on it. Do you have any question for me? Because I am here just
Thank you very much, Elvira. Now, actually, we give the floor to Linda Laura.
But ah, she arrived finally because she had the connection problem.
No problem.
Ah, bene, bene. I'm very, very happy.
Let me thank you for your insight in the history of W20. Now we know better the way it works. And now we are ready to give the floor and to welcome Linda Laura Sabbadini, Central Director of ISTAT, the Italian National Institute of Statistics, and Chair of W20. Let me just, between the many things I've read about her, let me just mention that in 2006 she has been nominated the Cavaliere all'Ordine del Merito della Repubblica Italiana for her innovative role in official statistics. So we are really looking forward to hear about the W20 roadmap. Thank you very much, Linda. I leave the floor to you.
Thank you very much for inviting us. It's a pleasure to stay with you. And sorry for my delay, but I have a lot of problems of connection. I want to start to this reflection. Besides the pandemic crisis, people all over the planet, and especially women, are at the epicenter of two other epochal processes, the climate crisis and the technological revolution, which have a negative impact mainly on women. And this will have a considerable social, economic, environmental impact for many years to come. And despite the urgency of the pandemic crisis having temporarily overloaded the other two critical challenges, and at the same time having raised their close interconnection, there is evidence that people, especially women, are increasingly facing many complex problems stemming the overlapping of the political, social, and economical fallouts of these three historical processes, especially in terms of decent work deficit in various different forms. And crisis time in this sense often provide the opportunities to achieve a very clear and wide sharing awareness on the need for governments to take previously delayed decisions. Such crises may offer the unique possibility of bringing out our forcing strength of positive changes. Or on the contrary, it may lead to a surrender to fears and resignation to widespread conflict. In the first case, decision made can result in a common and shared growth and well-being. In the second case, wider inequality gaps at every level may be experiences. In this general scenario, the social, economic, and political condition of women and girls must be raised as a main issue to be faced and managed by future strategies and policies. And the lack of empowerment of women and girls and the high degree of social and economic exclusion at the same time represent a human right, issue which hinder democratic development by disabling social and economic growth. We are working about the main aspect of our strategy at the moment with all delegation. But we think we have five strategic points to underline. First strategic point. I think we should change the perspective, avoiding a defensive approach on the inclusion of women. Avoiding small steps. Women, we know, are not a disadvantaged people to include. They are half of the world. And for this reason, we have to adopt a challenging vision of women's empowerment. And it's difficult to carry out this kind of strategies because we normally the strategy is only inclusion of women. But now we have a challenge. The challenge is to design policies as empowerment point of view, and in the full meaning of self-affirmation at all levels, even but not only in decision-making role. Positive actions, gender procurement measure must be adopted by governments, measure to combat the male monopoly in decision making are very crucial to make a jump in gender equality. This is only the first aspect. Second strategical point, I think we have to consider. There must be a strong commitment by government to ensure female employment growth. The 2014 G20 Brisbane target called to increase the labor force population, which includes both employed and unemployed people. And we must go beyond Brisbane, adopting an objective on the growth of women employment. We have to integrate a new indicator based on female employment rate, and female employment must improve from quantitative and qualitative point of view, and we have to push government to adopt measures to lighten the family workload on women, investing and strengthening social services, education and health infrastructure, especially public. And government should adopt mandatory paternity leave long enough to develop processes of sharing a family responsibility. And government have to really support female entrepreneurship with incentives, access to credit, and a strong investment in training. The third strategical point is a global plan against gender stereotypes and for cultural change. This is a very, very important point. raising awareness of their existence is essential to fight them. And stereotypes are internalized since childhood and condition the behaviors of women who unconsciously limit themselves in the realization of their desires and those of men. And we think that this point is very important in our roadmap, in the roadmap of the G20 countries. Every government had to adopt a global plan, a national plan against gender stereotypes and for cultural change. It's possibly, I don't know if we can obtain this objective, but we have to try, because it's a very important point. Intervention must be carried out in a systemic and permanent way with a funded national plan, action that must accompany schooling from childhood and training action on multipliers, interventions also on the culture of respect and of care. This is a very important point. A fourth point is that governments must launch a global plan on violence against women in all forms, including new forms of technological and digital violence, cyber violence. We have to study which is the best word to use. But it's very important to enforce the accompaniment of women in the path of exit from violence through the conquest of their autonomy, their economic independence. And by developing shelters in the territory, making health and police places suitable for welcoming victims of violence. And fifth, it's very important, the fifth strategical point, accompanying the ecological transition and by enhancing the female talents who have led the battles in defense of the earth and have been a pillar against the pandemic. We want to develop some reflection about the research, the development of the research in the field of gender medicine and in the field of One Health. Finally, Ilaria Capua collaborates with us in designing this the aspect about One Health, and Flavia Franconi for gender medicine. And finally, I think it's very important the recommendation at the G20 to adopt a gender approach who considers intersectionality, the different situations of different women. I think these are the main aspect we want to carry out in our work and recommendation for the G20. Finally, only few words about the measurement and monitoring of all the strategy of the G20 in the area of gender equality. We need indicators. We need gender equality indicators. We need to monitor these indicators. And we have the necessity of the impact impact evaluation of the laws on gender equality. I think that the this G20 is very important because for the first time, leaders have to design a roadmap. In the past, it's the first time and it's an historical year. For this reason, I think we have to think about it and choose three or four very strong objectives to put inside. And it's very important if we can discuss together about this. And I'm very happy if we can discuss together about all the strategical points we are defining in these days. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Linda Laura, for your extensive and inspiring description of the W20 roadmap. I think that after your speech, everyone feels more involved in the subject, and maybe every one of us thinks on how we can contribute in our life with our work to this important moment in our life. And now let me invite to the floor to Martina Rogato. Martina is a sustainability advisor, a lecturer, and a women's rights activist. She's a co-founder of a Young Women Network. She's also a TED speaker and nominated among the 1,000 women that are changing Italy with their social activism by Startup Italia. At the moment, she's also the Sherpa and the spokeswoman at W20 Italy. And I'm really delighted to give her the floor. Please, Martina.
Thank you so much, Milena, Girly, Monica, and the entire, the whole PWA for this invitation. I'm very happy of being here and also have the chance of talking with an organization I've discovered a few years ago when I moved as a Calabrese in Rome, and to see many familiar friends connected here. So thank you so much for this invitation. And now I will focus my intervention on where is Women 20 now, sharing with you more details and continue the intervention that Dr. Sabadini and Dr. Marasco did before me. We have just launched our kickoff meeting almost 1 month ago, when we officially start our path for gender equity and women empowerment. We met virtually our 100th delegate in 20 countries, and together we shared the first draft of our communique, the official documents containing our suggestion and recommendation for the G20. And I'm very happy to share that in order to create, before creating this document, we involved more than 200 associations, including PWA and other associations coming from Inclusione Donna, in a stakeholder engagement consultancy, in a national dialogue, in order to ask to all all Italian associations focused on women empowerment, the cutting edge issues related to our national priorities. So I'm very happy we had the chance of listening also PWA associate and ask them about our Italian priorities. So the communique we have launched last month is a resume of our let's say historical knowledge, our internal expertise, plus our international delegates expertise together with the national consultation output. So thank you so much for providing us lots of suggestions. As mentioned by my colleague, the G20 this year will be focused on three main pillars, people, planet, prosperity. And I'm very happy to discover that the G20 also introduced the concept of One Health, connecting people and women health with the, let's say, fights for for the health of the planet Earth. So the G20 found a synergy between the women health, the people health, and the planet Earth safeguarding. So we are very happy of this positioning, and considering the historical background of Women 20 together with the three main priorities of the G20, we decided to focus our 2021 intervention of five main topics. As mentioned by Dr. Sabadini, we will work on labor, digital, entrepreneurship, that I know is a very close topic to your association, together with environmental sustainability and violence against women and girls. And these five topics were the five pillars of our first draft of the communique. Now, after the very first delivery last month, we are negotiating among the delegation, and we will deliver a final communique. We will publicly deliver our communique in the middle of July during our Women 20 Summit that we hope will be held live in Rome, and have the chance of hosting all of you live in Rome in our 2 days, 3 days event. So now we are in the bargaining process. Please take into consideration that we approve each word by consensus among delegates. So no majority, but consensus. And this year we have the challenging opportunity of, let's say, advocating for the leaders' declaration. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the G20 procedures, but usually every year the G20 deliver a leader's declaration that is an official document of commitments of all 20 countries. And every year we try to improve the paragraph addressed to gender equity and women empowerment. And this year we have the opportunity beyond the leaders' declaration, that is a fundamental goal for us, to influence the roadmap, this action plan on women empowerment. So we will this year we will have a communique focusing on policies, but also we hope to have the chance of propose concrete indicators and measurement tools for measuring women empowerment and female occupation too. A very important things I like to stress is that so you can imagine that it's not so easy to realize a communique and agreed each word, word by word, in among 20 countries. So this is why we discuss a lot. We arrange a lot of meetings and dissemination events among our delegates. And obviously we are in contact with our national institutions and the Sherpa office in order to, let's say, be involved inside the official consultation and dialogue. Is very important to us to express our positioning and understand in details the G20's priorities. We are in contact with the national institution, the Sherpa office, together with other engagement groups. We are 8 official engagement groups of the G20. We are, as Women 20, the vertical topic focused on women. And then there are other groups on urban issue, business issues, and we often work together each year to find synergies and deliver a joint statement. For example, last year, we worked a lot on COVID recommendation, and you can find all the documents, all of our joint recommendation, the official website of Saudi Arabia, and also in our new website delivered thanks to our head of communication, Katia, last month. That is w20italia.it. So I highly recommend you to consult it. And we are very happy if you have any questions for us. We are very happy to reply.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Martina, for your precious information. And also for your ability in engaging the audience and also in encouraging us to pursue the project for a better world tomorrow. So really, thank you for your enthusiasm. And now let me go through some questions that we received via email when our guests joined the meeting. So there is a question about women project managers working in the private sector that are less paid than men project managers. What is the reason for that? In general, how is it possible still that women are less paid than men doing the same job? Is there anyone in the panel that wants to answer to this question?
I just want to say one thing. This is, yes, a terrible thing. We are work on it. It's not easy. We can say, I'm not agree when people say, because you do part-time and that's why at the end of the day, you have many money in your pay. There are a lot of reasons. I think the only reason that really I can accept is that things, they were like this till now. Now, from now on, they could start to change due to the effort that all of us are doing, pushing our institution also to follow our suggest. Because I'm sure that this is not a problem that can be solved only with a law. It's a mentality that all the companies, they should start to raise to all the people. And we will not have the gender equity in everything, pay gap will be always a problem. So this is the co-sherpa.
Our pleasure to introduce you, Olivia, that is the official co-sherpa of the Women 20.
Olivia. So anyway, I want to stop. This is something that we talk about a lot about this problem. I think that we are on the road to solve this big problem. I leave the floor to Martina, but I think that she wants to add something.
Could you please clarify more your questions? It's a matter of cultural change. I completely agree with Elvira, but I'm not sure I get the point. Thank you.
You mean to clarify the question?
Yes.
Basically, the person says that particularly women project managers working in the private sector are less paid than men project managers. But in general, we know that women are less paid than men. What is the reason for that? Talking about equality.
Okay. Well, I think there are different reasons. I'm not a psychologist, but okay. Psychologists used to say that usually women are not, comfortable on negotiating their salary. And this could be a reason. But I repeat, I'm not a psychologist, but I read it a lot of articles on it. So my invitation is to bargaining more on our salary for asking for a better salary. And the reason behind maybe is a cultural matter, is a cultural issues as mentioned and shared by Elvira concerning, I don't know, I don't want to use a strong word to reply, but probably is something really related on discrimination and our inequality. But I highly recommend to ask more when I have to bargain as a sustainability advisor, when I have to bargaining more, I always feel unconfident and worried, scared. I don't like to negotiate about money. So probably we need to improve, empower more women on talking frankly, spontaneously on economical issues. I think that historically we were not so much in contact with these business issues like men. So I think it's a cultural change that we need to do improve. Maybe I'm in favor, this is not the official Women 20 position, I'm in favor of, this is a personal opinion, on a mandatory approach on a pay gap.
Okay. So I come to the next question. We talked about green economy. So we see everywhere that the COVID crisis has also hit very hard the women employment. But we see also that richer countries are preparing huge stimulus plan. Do you believe that we have a real opportunity to shift at the same time towards a green economy and more inclusive one? But what about women condition in poorer countries instead in this specific context? So it is going to be easier for rich countries to recover and also to implement a green economy plan compared to poor countries?
This is an old story. I think Monica, she could answer probably better than us, eh? Monica. Disappeared.
Monica. No, I'm here. Can you see me?
Ciao.
Yes. Thank you for calling me in. The issue of developing countries and two-speed economy and development, it's very tricky. If you look at certain indicators in terms of development, obviously there are countries which are lagging behind more than others. So the agenda, it's always, I mean, if we take the case of COVID and the impact of COVID on women in developing countries, COVID is a crisis. As Linda very clearly said in her intervention, a crisis is a crisis. COVID is, for women, is another crisis. We went through the financial crisis in the past, and women are always the one paying a higher price in terms of unemployment, difficult access to new opportunities, work opportunities, cultural opportunities, everything. So, we did a survey during the COVID time last year in a number of countries from the MENA region. And what was coming out was very clear. so that those who had started a business, for example, they were obliged to close down because certain conditions of the market were becoming extremely difficult for women entrepreneurs. And during COVID time, they were obliged to close the business completely. But we know also that some business was closed in Europe, business run by women. I mean, the issue is that the quality of employment for women is critical. Most of times it's unstable, informal, and the more you go towards developing countries and the more you see informality. So obviously those women in the informal sector are more exposed to the bad impact of a crisis. When we talk about transition development, transition to a green economy and development, we are talking about a set of inputs that you require to do the transition. First of all, financial resources. Secondly, technology, knowledge. Now, women already have a difficulty in accessing financial resources, technology, and knowledge. Imagine what happened in a crisis situation. So I don't know if Linda, I can see Linda was saying yes with her head, if she wants to add something to what I said, but I mean, I think this is the general and overall picture.
Yes.
This is why it's very important that the financial resources that are being allocated now for the COVID crisis have a quota for women. It's not only mainstreaming, but it has to be specific intervention to facilitate women and to support them, to fill the gap. Linda, I don't know if you want to add something.
No, I think you are right. I agree. This is the point.
May I add something as a green professional?
Please.
I think there is a strong misunderstood. I mean, green need technologies for sure and financial skills for sure, but environmental sustainability don't need just technology and financial skills. We need transversal competencies, strategical competencies. So I know there are a lot of bias related to women and STEM, S-T-E-M, but as a sustainability professional, I think women can succeed in sustainability and green professions. So from one end, I completely agree with Linda, Laura, and Monica. We need to focus on the fact there is a strong technological issues. But to the other hand, we do not need just engineering, my respect for engineering, but we need strategies for delivering sustainability. We need also empathy for developing stakeholder engagement and do not causing adverse impact on the planet. So we need a different skill to succeed in the green economy, and women are perfect. Then I completely agree with you. We need to invest in education on sustainable financing. There are very innovative tools on sustainable finance that the majority of the Italians and the women don't know. And we need to invest on STEM and sustainability too. We can't do twice what we did with STEM. We lost the opportunity of creating new female occupation with STEM. And now we are running to trying to recover this gap. We can miss the opportunity twice with sustainability and green jobs.
Thank you, Martina. I totally agree with you. I think that also education and above all in the STEM subjects, it's definitely very, very important. And you know, the kind of books they have when the girls, they grow up, you know, on STEM and I want to be an engineer and not a ballerina or things like that, I think are very, very important. Oh, I feel I have two boys, but I feel that it is a very important subject. And actually we had a question of the STEM on STEM that I think you replied already. And there is now a question about the person's rights. What would be the unique differentiating factor for the this year W20 roadmap for women empowerment when compared to the previous W20 or other advocacy groups. What is holding back G20 members and other nations from rolling out some of the brilliant recommendation by W20 in the past? So something is going to change this year?
Who is going to answer? I think yes. Yes, we are stronger. We grow up. The problem that we are at the beginning, it was, let's say, an effort of few people, few female. Now we are really a lot of people that we are working on these problems and we want to solve it. And I think we can have a big voice. We can push to the authorities, to the institution, and it will be, I am an optimist, okay? This is my character. I want to be optimist. I see a difference between the other W20 I participated because I was there from the beginning, and now we are really a big strong, the strongness. We have much more competencies. We know how to handle with the institution. We all know how to propose our solutions, and we have a lot of experts that they are helping us. It is not easy because we must be always watching what they are doing, because I tell you one little difference. The other prime minister before, he used to talk about gender equality often. This one, not. So I don't think that it will be such a big difference in the proposal and the, but at the end of the day, I really don't read any more attention to this gender equality, to the W20. Before, it was much more on the video, on the newspaper, on the talk show. If you realize now, it's like it is a little bit disappeared, but we are like sentinel watching what is happening. And I think that Linda Laura, she could tell us what she feels, if really she agrees with my feeling. I think yes, but I want that she say to us her feeling. Hey, Linda Laura, where are you?
The microphone.
Microphone.
We can't hear you, the microphone.
Or Monica or Martina, she cannot answer.
Yes, yes, I think she's having any trouble with the
microphone. Mute. Yeah.
Because I don't want to say the old optimist. I want that really all the voice of women 20 is now Martina.
Okay, in the meantime, I don't know if you can hear me. Okay, in the meantime, let me say this year we have a very good opportunity. G20 is back in Europe after Germany. So we need to be ambitious and positive and maintain the goals very high. For the first time in the history, we have a roadmap. So our main goal would be to support the G20, to advocate the G20 on create an impactful roadmap with concrete indicators, maybe going beyond and valorizing more Brisbane, maybe with occupational indicators. And our goal is to, let's say, maybe improve the gender lens from gender to intersectionality and continuing the dialogue. Our colleague before us from Saudi Arabia did a great job, considering the starting point of Saudi Arabia. They did a tremendous job inserting 15 lines in the leader's declaration. We need to improve the commitment of G20. And trying to convinced leaders and institutions. I see some representatives here together connected with us in focusing on the importance of considering gender mainstream and not as our chair used to say every day, not a, a category. We are half of the world numerically, and so we need to be equally correctly represented. So gender should be mainstream. This is our main goal.
Okay, thank you.
Now?
Yes, go on.
Oh. I think we are more challenging. And this is very important. We know that we can win all together, and this is the way: determination, passion, and competence.
Definitely, thank you very much. Now, a question from our chat to all panelists. Did you personally have experience of gender bias? Can you share something of your stories? Anything you remember or anything you want to share with us?
I suffer every day a bias concerning my age. I'm 37, and before having the right to speak, people told me, oh, she's so young. I want to be no more discriminated about my age. And as a woman, I'm discriminated too about my gender. So I'm the worst category of the world, 37 and women. Maybe in the next 10 years, we will improve it. But it's always like that. Thanks for the question. I have always to demonstrate my value first. Then I have the right to speak and share my thoughts. But I'm very curious to know about your bias cases.
No, I have a bias cases, horrible bias cases. You know, I am a journalist. 10 years ago, yes, Masuma, I was invited in a program to talk about sex. It was a very funny program. 20 more, I think 20 times I was there. I don't remember. Anyway, we talk about sex in all the perspective, how you do sex, you like to do women, men, so everything, but was made in a very funny way. There were special guests like Massimo Cacciari, Frank Caram, she was alive. People very funny that we did the program, very exciting. What's happened? At the moment, I was the consultant, senior advisor of a gender association. One of these person, two of these person of the association, they said that I couldn't do the senior advisor of this gender association because I was, I have a lot content. I could be consulting, yes, but consulting of sex, not of institutional relation or whatever, you know? So they broke my contract because of this. I say, maybe I am better. This is what my answer was. Yes, this is a gender bias. If I was a man, everybody was looking at me and say, oh, how sexy you are, how good you are. I want to go to bed with you. Because I was a woman, several women, they decide that I was not competent. I didn't have the competencies to do international relation because I was participating in a program talking about sex. This is my story. Anyway, I can laugh on it now.
I'm sorry. So, Linda, Laura, or Monica, do you want to share anything?
Yeah, of course. I will change environment. Instead of a journalist talking about sex, something more down to earth. working place. I found myself in a situation in which I was chief in a department with three others, male director and chiefs. And there was a constant, continuous, it lasted at least almost a couple of years. There was a constant discrimination in terms of participating to meetings. I was not invited to meetings which were taking place in the overall organization. Assignment of tasks. And even, you know, one of the thing that they say, it's typical of a gender bias in a meeting is when you intervene as a woman, and then the one who intervenes, a male colleague intervenes after you, and he says similar things to what you are saying. And then the third person, instead of making reference to you, makes reference to him, saying, as you know, like Paul said, and not like Monica. So, which is a typical thing, if you notice that in meetings with men, they always support each other, and they deny what you are saying if it is something, you know, that is then repeated by a man. So I was in that situation for a while. I was very surprised because you don't expect that to happen in the UN system. And I had to involve the human resources and other department of the organization and write it down and highlight that to the people with whom I was working. And I had a very straightforward conversation with the director highlighting that. But it was very, very unpleasant. And I must say, I know that there are many situations like that. Even, you know, this is one example that comes to my mind. But in the working environment, there are many situations where you find yourself really facing a gender bias. And sometimes you don't have a solution. I think in the public sector, somehow you are more protected by the rules. In the private sector is more difficult, I think.
Thank you. Thank you, Monica. I don't know if Linda Laura wants to share something with us.
I think she's not there. Oh, no, she's there.
No, she's there, but the microphone.
Yes. It's it's very difficult to be a free woman between a team of men who consider gender and social statistics a secondary aspect for years and years. It's very, very difficult. And after career awards, they took away my management positions. I was too free for them, too far out of the rules. And but I'm resilient. I'm resilient, and now I'm director of National Statistical Institute.
Fantastic. Talking about STEMs.
Yes. Passion, determination, and competence. So this is the three magic words.
Passion, determination, and competence. Thank you very much. Thank you, Amina. I would be here hours and hours to and time flies, but let me now give the floor to Gerli for her comments.
I have a lot of stories to tell you, but then tonight we're just so grateful to have all of you. You are Linda Laura Sabadini, Elvira Marasco, Monica Carcoa, and of course, our dear Martina Rogato. And this is such a very human conversation, and this is what we need at the moment. What we wanted to show is a panel of women who is actually making progress, okay, on behalf of us. And in the beginning, I made a call on individuals as a woman, as an organization, and as a nation to support the W20 team. And you met them tonight. They are also like us. They have encountered our situations. They live the life that we are living. We face the same problems, but then they are there to solve it. I think that our passion and determination really put us forward to make things happen. And this call, this meeting tonight will really, you know, it will instill in each one of us that we are part of this. We are, each one of us is important. Every small commitment to further the progress of women's empowerment across all the areas we're in the agenda of 2020, planet, prosperity, and success. I'm very confident that inclusion of women comes into reality in all policies one day, including when it is integrated in the production of the well-being of our society. It's just as simple as that. And I'm sure that there's no better time to transform our current way of life into one with more economic gender inclusivity. We are here together, and I hope this inspires you, this kind of meeting that is very natural and open, and it inspires you to continuously support the W20 team. Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much for being here. I would like to conclude with just a phrase from Linda Laura Sabatini, that is, the battle for gender equality does not only concern women, but all of the world, and must emerge as a priority for the whole G20. So we really hope that with also the recovery plan, as Monica was saying, would be possible to have a part, maybe a large part, sometimes they say half, maybe it's too much, but still have a part of these funds for the equity, for the politics for gender equality. So let me thank all of you, and hope to see you soon. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Grazie. Grazie per aver partecipato, grazie. E grazie per questo splendido panel.
Grazie a voi.
Grazie a voi, veramente. Grazie mille.
Grazie, Katia.
Grazie.
Grazie Milena, Gerli.
A te, cara.
Grazie a te, con tutti questi meetings che avevi, sei stata molto carina a riuscire a farcela, grazie.
Ma avevo anche un mansplaining in questi 10 minuti che doveva spiegare a me come si faceva una cosa che devo fare per loro. Vabbè, cioè, ormai, io ho imbruttito.
Noi però siamo multitasking, siamo donne, quindi di queste cose le possiamo fare.
Ciao Florana,
ciao, grazie,
ciao, a presto, cara.
Ciao.